iBridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Oceans Rise, Empires Fall, Why Geopolitics Hastens Climate Catastrophe, by Gerard Toal, read by Al Kessel. Introduction. Rising Threats. A decade ago, a threat rose from the ocean. By pumping vast amounts of sand onto living coral reefs and mixing cement to create concrete foundations, a fleet of dredging machines from China raised a string of artificial islands across the internationally disputed waters of the South China Sea. Built upon the newly reclaimed land was a familiar island infrastructure: ports, hangars, towers, lighthouses, and housing. But there was more: large runways, radar installations, missile batteries, reinforced bunkers, and fortified point defense systems. China was expanding. Xi Jinping became the paramount leader of China in 2012. The following year, China built 20 artificial outposts on the Paracel Islands and 70 on the Spratly Islands, reclaiming about 3,200 acres of land from the sea as new Chinese territory. The strategy, dubbed the Great Wall of Sand by U.S. Pacific Fleet Commander Admiral Harry Harris, created a chain of military infrastructures and fortifications that enabled the Chinese Navy and Air Force to project hard power across the region. These have also backed up more assertive ownership claims by China over the surrounding volumes of water and air. Before China's territorial moves in the South China Sea, the prevailing U.S. perception of China was of a peacefully rising world power. China's creation of new territories for itself on the sea, however, helped change that. Strategists saw China's practices in the South China Sea as a challenge to U.S. dominance in the Pacific and, more generally, to the rules of a liberal international order. Did China seek exclusive control of the South China Sea? An estimated $2.5 trillion worth of oil and gas reserves on the ocean floor, as well as control of rich fishing resources, were said to be at stake. The 1.4 million square mile expansive sea accounts for approximately 12% of the total global fish catch. The South China Sea also handles roughly one-third of the world's ocean-going trade. Old marine maps with dashed lines showed, according to China, that it owned the South China Sea. New island forts and aggressive territorial behavior now backed up this spurious claim. Surely this was proof that China was becoming a threat and that it wanted to replace the United States as the most powerful country in the Pacific, if not the whole world. Amidst this wave of strategic anxiety, a few sharp-eyed analysts noticed something more. The infrastructure that the Chinese Navy had so quickly and impressively constructed was not doing so well. Rumors suggested that the concrete was crumbling and the foundations were turning to sponge. Exposed metal was corroding quickly. An artillery gun, one researcher reported, was put out of service in just 3 months because of rust. Others noticed that China's hasty island construction had destroyed many fragile coral ecosystems across the South China Sea. These supported rich fishing grounds, which provided protein to millions in Asia. Overfishing, especially by Chinese factory ships which bullied smaller Vietnamese and Filipino fishing boats on the water, also threatened the sustainability of the South China Sea's fishing stocks. Oceanic pollution, particularly from plastics waste, was a serious problem too. Further issues were visible on the instruments of the scientific community: rising ocean temperatures and acidity levels, increasing storm intensities, and sea level rise. The latter was already threatening low-lying islands in other parts of the Pacific. Human habitation on Pacific island nations such as Vanuatu, Tuvalu, Fiji, Kiribati, and the Marshall Islands is seriously jeopardized by rising seas, degraded fishing, and more frequent storm surges connected to climate change. Would China's new island formations suffer the same fate? Was their construction an expression of power or of hubris? the desire to capture untapped fossil fuel reserves on the ocean floor is a presumed motivation for Chinese island building in the South China Sea. But the climatic consequences of the fossil fuel-burning energy systems that have powered the capitalist global economy for more than a century threaten to overwhelm the entire endeavor. Indeed, unless modern civilization sharply reduces greenhouse gas emissions, the oceans are expected to swallow large swaths of land over the next quarter century. According to current estimates, approximately 150 million people now live on land that will be below the high tide line by 2050. Shanghai and its surroundings, a vital hub in the global economy, will be submerged unless there is a massive engineering response. Bangkok in Thailand, Mumbai in India, Ho Chi Minh City in Vietnam, and many other cities around the world will follow suit. Southern Vietnam, once fought over with massive firepower and toxic chemicals to keep communism at bay, may also be lost to rising tides. Climate change is shifting the earthly foundations of our geopolitics. World powers today face a fundamentally new question. Are rising Earth temperatures and sea levels a greater emergency than the rising power of rival states? The question is increasingly insistent, yet the trade-offs and choices it demands are not yet clearly grasped and debated in democratic societies. Some policymakers understand that climate breakdown is an unprecedented planetary emergency, one that demands a radically new collaborative international order. Most state security institutions and politicians, though, are fixated on economic and military competition against rival world powers. Few consider the deeper problem, namely, that geopolitical practices themselves are a major structural driver of the climate crisis. In obsessively promoting their own security, mission, and military might, world powers have long played geopolitics against each other, at the expense of the planet. To understand the climate crisis fully, we need to see the practices of geopolitics geo-ecologically. We need, in other words, to earth geopolitics. Modernity exposed. Chinese island building in the South China Sea opens up much larger questions about territorial formation and modernity. Over the last six centuries, humans have dramatically increased their capacity to mold the earth to their requirements. Terraformation, the making of land, the reworking of the natural environment to serve specific groups, is an enduring human drive. Terra, while often equated with fixed dry land, actually encompasses all sorts of terrains, themselves never singular, but interacting. Lands and seas, rivers and fields, mountains and valleys, wetlands and plains, deserts and tundra. All lands and seas, however, are not themselves without the planet's atmosphere and the dynamic hydrological and atmospheric processes that are climate. In clearing forests, cultivating crops, and burning materials for energy, humans started altering its chemical composition. For most of our species' history, human societies developed their capacity for terraformation in very limited and localized ways. The development of a capitalist world economy anchored in Europe from the 15th century onward changed this, giving birth to a massive terraforming enterprise that is still working itself out across the vast spaces of the planet. Modernity is a one-word name for this remarkable environmental engineering project, a connected flowing network of resources, commodities, states, peoples, technologies, and importantly, pollution. Modernity sought to harness the planet's dynamic geophysical processes and biospheres to serve the specific economic, social, and state interests associated with capitalism's global expansion as a mode of production and exchange. The project's crucible was initially Spain and Portugal, then the Dutch Republic, then the British Empire, and finally the United States. Now the world economy is global, with just a few earthly spaces beyond its extractive imperatives. This global economy is configured along grooves established over hundreds of years, pathways for the flow of investments, peoples, and commodities that once coexisted with the movements of soldiers, priests, weapons, and diseases, and still do in certain instances. Global cities are the organizational nodes of the vast system, sustaining dense concentrations of humanity while altering the Earth's geo-ecological systems with relentless extraction and pollution. Capitalist modernity always had a great story to tell, of expansion and growth, of development and progress, as modern humans gradually acquired greater power over their surroundings and freed themselves from prior constraints. But these familiar stories of progress, of modernization, of inexorable growth on a bountiful earth are no longer as persuasive as they once were. Modernity is a dream of making the world better, of providing further growth, superior technologies, and greater affluence for all. Yet, it is perpetually thwarted by crises and crashes, wars and collapses. It demands the earth, and then some. Classical modernity saw the transformation of traditional societies into industrial societies, first through the adoption of steam power, then the widespread adoption of coal, and later petroleum for energy. Following World War II, industrial societies experienced a second wave of modernity associated with the adoption of new techno-scientific forms of production and consumption. Proliferating infrastructures of hydrocarbon fuel extraction, transportation, and consumption were supplemented by nuclear power systems. Industrial societies became what the German sociologist Ulrich Beck in 1986 termed world risk society, with abundance coexisting with more intrusive forms of pollution. This second modernity is a reflexive modernization, one constantly striving to adjust to the success and excess, the side effects that are always much more than this, of classical modernity. But it is still modernity, a dream of endless growth. That dream has produced the ecological crises that are now surrounding us and that claim the future. The modes of common life that have arisen largely within the last 100 years and whose intensity has accelerated only since 1945, the historian Timothy Mitchell observes, are shaping the planet for the next 1,000 years and perhaps the next 50,000. Modernity's side effects are now taking center stage. While many societies hold fast to the dream of modernization, updated to include solar panels and wind farms, the scientific findings on the current and likely future trajectory of global climate changes suggest that life on the human-dominated Earth created by modernity is going to be radically different from what it has been until now. Climate change is just one of the interconnected series of distressed Earth systems. Biosphere integrity is threatened by collapsing biodiversity, land system change, biogeochemical imbalances, disrupted hydrological systems, atmosphere aerosol loading, ozone depletion, ocean acidification, and endemic pollution from novel entities introduced by techno-scientific modernity. The latest round of Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, IPCC reports, makes it clear that Earth's surface temperatures are going to keep going up. Each of the past four decades has been successively warmer than any decade that preceded it since 1850. The global surface temperature rise since then is approaching 1.5 degrees Celsius and will almost certainly exceed this in the next year or so. Climate breakdown is radically changing oceans as temperatures and acidity levels rise sharply. Around 90% of the energy trapped in the climate system by greenhouse gases goes into the ocean. The hottest ocean temperatures in recorded history were in 2022, the seventh consecutive year this record was broken. And 2023 has almost certainly surpassed this. Combined with acidification and pollution, these spikes in temperature have devastating effects on marine life and ocean ecosystems. Their effects on ocean circulation systems are a matter of considerable concern. Average sea levels are also rising at an unprecedented rate. The rate of global mean sea level rise, according to satellite data, has doubled between the first decade of observations, 1993 to 2002, at 2.27 millimeters per year, and the latest, 2013 through 2022, at 4.62 millimeters per year. Massive sea level rise scenarios are on the horizon. The threshold of global temperature rise that would trigger irreversible melting on the planet's enormous ice sheets in Greenland and Antarctica is estimated to lie between 1.5 degrees and 2.0 degrees Celsius. Current research suggests warmer tides are eroding the seafloor moorings of huge glaciers in both of these critical Earth system regions, rendering them increasingly unstable. Geomorphological realities matter crucially. The West Antarctic ice sheet lies largely below current sea level and is thus particularly vulnerable to warmer ocean waters undermining it from below. A collapse of the Pine Island Glacier and Thwaites Glacier will raise global sea level by 1.2 meters, 4 feet. This will undermine the West Antarctic ice sheet, and its disintegration would add another 3.3 meters, 11 feet, in global mean sea level rise. Antarctica, as a whole, holds enough ice to raise sea levels by 60 meters, 200 feet. The tipping points here are uncertain, but it is entirely possible that global sea levels could rise by a meter or more by the end of this century. Indeed, the recent IPCC report noted that global sea level rise approaching 2 meters by 2100 and 5 meters by 2150 cannot be ruled out under its high emission scenario due to deep uncertainty about ice sheet disintegration processes. No matter what the scenario, current 1 in 100-year extreme sea level events are projected to occur at least annually in more than half of all tide gauge locations by 2100. The extent to which these trends continue depends on the interaction of multiple Earth system dynamics, but nonlinear change is expected as tipping points, cascade effects, and feedback loops work themselves out. The scale of recent changes across the climate system, as well as the current state of many aspects of this system, is unprecedented over the last 125,000 years. The past 9 years have been the hottest in recorded human history. The year 2023 was the first with all days over 1 degree Celsius hotter than the pre-industrial average. A third of its days were 1.5 above this. There is no future scenario that does not involve significant adaptation to higher temperatures, as this is already built in due to accumulated greenhouse gas emissions which can linger in the atmosphere for thousands of years. At the annual United Nations climate summits, the gap between the pledges of delegate states to reduce emissions and the material realities of actual emissions is increasingly stark. Even factoring in existing decarbonization pledges, the trajectory of emissions suggests that the planet is headed for a median 2.8 degrees Celsius temperature increase by the end of this century. Explaining collective failure. Clearly, modern civilization is headed for catastrophe if it continues to produce greenhouse gases at the rate it has for the past century, and especially the past few decades. The alarming trajectory of the Earth system is now well known. Newspapers cover the topic regularly with ever more alarming updates and summaries of scientific reports. It is crystal clear that modern human civilization is not acting in its collective best interest. Despite having abundant scientific evidence that humanity's future is imperiled and that climate catastrophe is a very real possibility, modern civilization continues to operate as normal, meaning in a future-destroying manner. Corporate elites and state leaders, educated and knowing, still act in ways that sabotage the future of their children and their children's children. Climate change is an existential threat that is not treated as an emergency. There are many theories that account for this indifference to looming catastrophe, a seeming civilizational death wish. Political economy explanations focus on the power structures that helped create the global environmental crisis. Marxist accounts focus on the historical development of capitalism as an extractive and environmentally degrading mode of production that favored monetary exchange value over non-monetary use value. Political ecology details how market logistics marginalize indigenous people, convert land into property, ignore pollution, and discount the future. Because it is a mode of production that has long prioritized short-term profits over the long-term sustainability of its extractive practices, capitalism is blamed both for the current environmental crisis and for an inability to do anything about it. It is easier to imagine the end of the world than the end of capitalism, is a popular summation of this sentiment. For some corporations, this was their actual working practice. Oil companies like Exxon Corporation, Exxon Mobil after its merger with Mobil Oil in 1999, knew for decades that their business of extracting and selling fossil fuels would result in a significant global temperature rise. From the late 1970s and early 1980s, its scientists accurately modeled and skillfully predicted global warming from fossil fuel burning. Yet the company's corporate strategy was to systematically deny and obscure this material reality. It made economic sense to pursue profits in the short term and discount the future consequences. In 2022, ExxonMobil earned a record $55.7 billion in profits, about $6.3 million every hour. Five of the West's largest energy companies, ExxonMobil, BP, Shell, Total Energies, and Chevron, reported a combined $195 billion in profit in 2022. Saudi Aramco, largely controlled by Saudi Arabia, alone recorded a record profit of $161 billion, a figure described as probably the highest net income ever reported in the corporate world. Philosophical examinations of the climate crisis examine the disenchantment of nature in modernity. This has been variously characterized as a shift from an organic to mechanical conception of land, and from a vitalist to a calculative conception of the earth. Early modern Christian theology justified human supremacy over nature and the expropriation of lands from non-Christian peoples, pagans, in the name of a parochial faith declared universal. Further, land was inanimate, a commodity that could be parceled and traded. The late French philosopher Bruno Latour argued that the modern worldview that separates nature from culture, or tries to at least, is a source of the environmental crisis. This cleavage leads to a devaluation of the natural world and a failure to recognize the actual material interconnectedness of things. Yet other explanations alight on the material dependencies of modernity. Modern human civilization is so reliant upon the consumption of fossil fuels for energy and many other activities that this is profoundly difficult to shift. Vaclav Smil identifies four pillars of modern civilization: cement, steel, plastics, and ammonia. The mass-scale production of all of these heavily depends on hydrocarbon use. Cement, steel, and plastics are indispensable materials in the construction of modern cities and infrastructures. Ammonia is vital in the production of nitrogenous fertilizers that make it possible for agriculture to produce sufficient food to support billions of people. Indeed, Smil suggests the modern world's most existential dependence on fossil fuels is their direct and indirect use in the production of food. Decarbonizing modernity is next to impossible, many argue, and may itself tempt catastrophe. Yet other explanations focus on the psychological roots of the crisis and the myriad of human cognitive biases that reward turning away rather than confronting the crisis. The satirical film Don't Look Up, for example, is an indictment of the narcissism of contemporary culture and media. Distraction and short-termism dominate. Humans are reluctant to make major changes to their lives absent an extreme and visible emergency. Even then, many would rather retreat into fantasy or fatalism. The constituency for action is not overwhelming, and it may never be. Indeed, it is almost inevitable that when global heating comes to dominate, it will already be too late to reverse the radical disruptions it will bring to human habitation across the earth. Clearly, the coming climate catastrophe does not have a single cause, but is rather a complex entanglement of many different factors. In any explanatory framework, one powerful factor, however, cannot be ignored: geopolitics. This book is an argument for why it is significant and why it needs comprehensive critical analysis. What is geopolitics? Geopolitics is an elastic term with many meanings. Today, it is most commonly associated with great power competition. A great power is a country with a large territory, population, economy, and military capacity. A status construct in international society, the term can obscure major differences between states, though it usually signifies a shared hubris for greatness. To certain state leaders and international relations scholars, great power competition is an endemic feature of the interstate system. Indeed, in recent years, this notion has become an obsession in Western strategic circles. Great power competition is now a catchphrase used to justify new rounds of military spending, new industrial policies, and new strategic alliances. A performative speech act that thinks itself merely descriptive, it has even earned its own Pentagon abbreviation, GPC. This new emphasis of great power competition is frequently cast in terms of a global clash of ideals and values, a struggle between democracy and authoritarianism. But the rivalry between the United States and China, and the United States and Russia, is also widely understood as a geostrategic struggle for relative power over the perceived material resources for future prosperity in world affairs. Though the United States and China are strongly connected by trade and investment networks, both states have become more explicit geoeconomic rivals. Under President Biden, the United States has restricted China's access to leading-edge technologies and has sought greater control over what it has deemed strategic supply chains and critical minerals. This has heightened frictions with China and has driven it into closer strategic alignment with Russia. Obscured in this discourse of competition, though, is something fundamental: the geo-ecological costs of great power rivalry. The geo-ecological wasn't always hidden. Geopolitics has an older definition, one notorious for justifying German imperial expansionism in Europe during World War II. German geopolitics, geopolitik, held that great powers were living organisms in a competitive struggle for space. Deprived of national territory and colonies by the Treaty of Versailles, intellectuals and revanchist politicians called for greater Lebensraum, living space, for the German people. This latter word became a rallying cry in Nazi Germany, one used to justify the territorial expansion of the Third Reich and the creation of a new order in Europe, organized around life and prosperity for Aryan Germans at the expense of all others. This is the dark mirror of the conventional understanding of geopolitics, geopolitics as racial geo-ecological imperialism. As climate breakdown deepens across the planet, the politics of living space is returning anew with great urgency. The Earth's biosphere has clear material limits and tipping points, most obviously the level of greenhouse gas concentrations in the planet's atmosphere. This so-called carbon budget for keeping heating below 1.5 degrees Celsius has largely been used up by just a few world powers, led by the United States and China, at the expense of everyone else. The resulting effects: climate breakdown, global heating, desertification, unprecedented flooding, and wildfires are violently remaking living spaces across the Earth. While some continue to live wealthy, high-emission lifestyles, others are having the ground pulled from beneath them. Climate change is rapidly creating unlivable spaces, places too hot, too polluted, too vulnerable to flooding, too ecologically stressed to sustain human flourishing. In short, we have the return of ineluctable questions of Lebensraum, this time at a planetary scale. Who gets to live well on the Earth, to have luxury spaces and lifestyles sustained by extractions and emissions that speed the planet toward climate catastrophe? Who gets marginalized and has to suffer the consequences of climate change brought on by the lifestyles of the rich? Who is forced to move in order to survive, to navigate expanding zones of uninhabitability? Understanding geopolitics as a struggle for Lebensraum is a critical provocation, one I use to highlight what should not be overlooked, the geoecological character of geopolitics. Defining geopolitics, in short, is more complicated than it seems. There are popular and self-serving ideological understandings of it, and more disturbingly dark ones too. China's island building in the South China Sea in 2015, in the wake of Russia's seizure of Crimea in 2014, catalyzed renewed discussion of territorial control and geopolitics in the power centers of the Western world. An aspect of this discussion was the naturalization of the West's own geopolitical order, territorial power, and geoecological imperialism. Geopolitics was presumed to have returned because of the actions of those revisionist powers, rather than to have always been present. The West's geopolitics took the rhetorical form of a liberal international order that aspired to universalism, a sphere of influence above all others. China and Russia were revisionists because they sought neighborhood spheres of influence that aggrandized their own state territory and challenged the West. Great power competition displaced the global war on terrorism as the prime directive for U.S. defense policy in the 2017 U.S. National Security Strategy document. Transnational terrorist networks and rogue states were still recognized as security challenges, but Russia and China were at the top of the threat list. The 2018 U.S. National Defense Strategy consolidated the shift by identifying the reemergence of long-term strategic competition from the revisionist powers Russia and China as the central challenge to U.S. prosperity and security. The Biden administration sought strategic stability with Russia in order to concentrate on strategic competition with China. This emphasis fell apart with the Russian military invasion of Ukraine. That war has consolidated the notion that the West is in a new era of great power competition with China and Russia, a strategic competition to shape the future of the international order. Locating the central challenge to U.S. prosperity and security in the actions of Russia and China is not an objective claim. Rather, it is evidence of the power of geopolitics as a world-making discourse to shape the recognition of threats and the meaning of security in world affairs. The deepening of tensions with Russia and China over Ukraine and Taiwan underscore the capacity of geopolitics to dominate the agenda of global politics and to reach into the everyday life of states all across the globe. Geopolitics is the triumph of the competitive territorial thinking of world powers. It locates threats in the territorial behavior of rival states. It defines emergencies based on the behavior of other states and associated non-state actors, and not modernity itself. Pushed to the side until they make themselves felt are the much more urgent common threats faced by all humans and other species from our own institutions and practices. Contemporary geopolitics and climate catastrophe. This book contends that a critical analysis of geopolitics is necessary to understand not only the climate catastrophe humanity is facing, but also why so little has been done to prevent it. Some will no doubt take issue with the word catastrophe, so let me explain what I mean by it and why I use it. The best available Earth science states that a planetary environment where global surface temperatures have risen about 2 degrees Celsius since 1800 will have catastrophic consequences for the world as we know it. The direct causes of this coming climate catastrophe are modern civilization's gargantuan emissions into the Earth's atmosphere of greenhouse gases, carbon dioxide, methane, nitrous oxide, fluorinated gases, and water vapor. This, along with the degradation and destruction of the planetary mechanisms that helped regulate solar radiation and greenhouse gas levels over the last geological epoch. Geopolitics is part of the problem, indeed, a major part of the problem. It has helped set modern human civilization on a trajectory toward a hothouse Earth. It also inhibits the collective action required to change this trajectory. That geopolitics hastens future climate catastrophe is already clear from a superficial examination of some features of international affairs today. Three in particular stand out. The first concerns the potential of geopolitical competition to induce a cataclysmic event that could immediately generate a climate catastrophe alongside civilizational collapse. There is always a danger of great power competition spiraling out of control and nuclear war breaking out across the Earth. Such an event, needless to say, would be disastrous, not only for the areas targeted and the states involved, but for the Earth as a whole. A nuclear war involving two or more great powers would likely trigger a nuclear winter, as enormous clouds of dust and debris would be driven into the upper layers of the Earth's atmosphere. Nuclear radiation fallout would spread across the Earth's surface, poisoning the biosphere possibly for thousands of years. Both events would radically alter the planet's biosphere and the life support systems for human settlements across the globe. Nuclear war would be an instant climate catastrophe. It would likely prompt an initial global cooling as debris clouds would prevent sunlight from reaching the Earth's surface. Unfortunately, we can no longer assume that this is a very low probability event. Nuclear tensions escalated considerably in the wake of Russia's flailing invasion of Ukraine and the West's considerable military support for Ukraine's aspiration to drive the Russian military out of Ukraine. The world's nuclear weapons control architecture is now in disarray. The possibility of a cataclysmic, system-wide nuclear war is always with us. The second is how geopolitical competition undermines the ability of the world's leading powers to work together on common security concerns. To have any chance of avoiding the worst outcomes of climate change, the largest state producers of greenhouse gases need to cooperate. China currently produces the largest tonnage of emissions, followed by the United States, which is the largest historical emitter and still the highest per capita by far. But geopolitical competition between the United States and China, especially over the status of Taiwan, blocks significant cooperation. The visit of then U.S. House Speaker Nancy Pelosi to Taiwan in August 2022 led China to cancel the modest dialogue that did exist. One analyst, the political scientist Michael Clare, puts the matter starkly: geopolitics will cost us our planet. Clare argues that both China and the United States need to establish a common front focused on the climate emergency, which he terms the U.S.-China Climate Survival Alliance. All other matters need to be subordinated to the goals of this alliance, which is to stop the continued production of the greenhouse gases that are imperiling not only the future of both states, but the future of all states in the world. The stakes could not be any larger. Yet, this is not happening. While the United States and China have resumed talks about climate change issues, there is no joint action commensurate with the alarming nature of the climate change threat to both of them and everyone else. Both are investing in competition. What makes the situation stranger is that most world leaders agree that climate change is a scientific fact and that it poses a major threat to how humans currently live. Yet, in practice, climate change takes second place to geopolitics. It is a new agenda item, not an item requiring a completely new agenda. Thus, there is no U.S.-China Climate Survival Alliance, but rather, competition over future technologies and current spheres of influence. Climate action, the development of decarbonization structures and clean energy technologies, is caught in competitive, not collaborative dynamics. Put bluntly, the geopolitical status of Taiwan and Ukraine appears more important than the future of humanity. The third is the connection between geopolitical practices and greenhouse gas emissions. Geopolitical competition and war are powerful drivers of fossil fuel use. Over the past two centuries, the competition between large industrial states has run on hydrocarbon energy. All of the so-called great powers, Great Britain, Germany, France, the United States, Russia, and later China, were endowed with considerable reserves of coal and exploited these to industrialize and grow their economies while also strengthening their militaries. That military capacity allowed them to expand their imperial ambition by projecting firepower. Maintaining military capacity itself through securing reserves of hydrocarbon energy well beyond their borders became a mission in itself, with the British Empire leading the way in creating an oceanic chain of coaling stations for its navy, and others, like the United States, playing catch-up. The shift from coal to oil as the fuel driving military machines, from battleships, trucks, and tanks to fighter aircraft and rockets, changed the game considerably. For now, control over oil production and supply lines was imperative for military capacity. It became an imperative for economic growth, too, as the many material advantages of oil over coal as a source of energy became apparent. After World War II, the modality of empire changed, and an informal oligopoly of Western oil companies, the Seven Sisters, dominated the world petroleum market until the 1970s. The U.S. military slowly adopted the role of a protection service for the hydrocarbon production and circulation system of the capitalist global economy. This worked in the Middle East through arms sales to Saudi Arabia and Iran, until popular revolution in the latter upended that relationship. As producer state power increased and hawkish geopolitical scaremongering rose also, the U.S. military was drawn further into the region as an interventionist force. The result was a series of wars with the control of oil reserves a persistent concern. The massive smoke plumes generated by Iraq's destruction of Kuwaiti oil well towers and deliberate burning of oil lakes and trenches in the Gulf War of 1991 visualized how destructive wars can be to the planet's atmosphere and ecology. The United States evicted Iraq from Kuwait that year using military firepower like M1A1 Abrams battle tanks, now operating in Ukraine, vehicles that consume 2 gallons of jet fuel per mile. U.S. fighter jets are even more voracious users of petroleum. Dominating its rivals in military expenditure, the U.S. military is the largest single institutional consumer of hydrocarbon fuels in the world. It has long been the largest polluter in the United States and is likely the most polluting institution in the world. Yet, because of its privileged position in the state, U.S. military emissions are untouchable. Indeed, the Kyoto Protocol of 1997 specifically excluded any counting of military emissions due to U.S. lobbying. This state of affairs has shifted somewhat as consciousness has grown that the deep cycle of fossil fuel use in the militarized pursuit of security directly contributes to a similarly fueled militarism by rival states and the collective destabilization of the world's climate. The carbon footprint, or so-called bootprint, of the military complexes of world powers is now being questioned. There is a growing realization that carbon combustion-based security undermines itself by fueling climate insecurity. There are many other features of contemporary geopolitics that also contribute to the prospect of climate catastrophe. The financial power of petrostates and their efforts to greenwash their role in accelerating global heating, the influence of the carbon combustion complex in capturing states and throttling anti-carbon action across states and within international organizations. There is also an emergent toxic culture war over climate action that features attacks by far-right forces on the transnational climate action movement. Add to this the long-standing challenges to strategic collective action planning, the power of immediacy, discounting the future, entrenched interests, ignorance, short-termism, and risk uncertainties. Some accounts of geopolitics and climate change are preoccupied with what climate change means for a future balance of power, who wins and who loses. The chessboard shifts. There is a new map of energy and power, but the game is presumed to continue much as before. I want to suggest that this chessboard conception of the planet is part of the reason why we have a climate emergency. It conceptualizes the Earth as the playground of great powers, a material space to be occupied and controlled to advance the victory of one power over another. The entrenched power of institutions built around this conceit helps explain the climate crisis. The metaphor displaces the material reality of the Earth, a dynamic planet of complex interdependencies and interlocking processes. In doing so, it hides the ecological costs of playing geopolitics. Geopolitics is territorial competition. Geopolitics did not always exist. It is not an inevitable feature of how humans live on the Earth. As a set of modern human beliefs and practices, it has a history and geography. Geopolitics first emerged as part of the modernity ushered in by European overseas expansionism and Christian imperialist capitalism. The first world powers, states with the capacity and reach to project power across the surfaces of the Earth, were European empires legitimated by papal decree to occupy and seize land. As these European states deepened their ambitions to exploit faraway territories, they developed competitive strategies to control terrestrial and maritime spaces. Geopolitics was born amidst imperial rivalry and extractive enterprises, civilizational missions, and territorial conquests. Its practices are part of the emergence of an integrated and singular Earth as globe, whose lands and seas, with the exception of the high seas and regions inhospitable to human settlement, were organized as territories that belonged exclusively to certain empires, states, and state-affiliated organizations. Geopolitics facilitates the claiming of the planet by modern humans. The British geographer and imperial reformer Halford John Mackinder, 1861 through 1947, termed the period of European overseas imperialism the Columbian Epoch. He described this, in Eurocentric terms, as a period of exploration and discovery of territories new to European eyes. But this epoch of open space, of unclaimed land, was over, had ended in the late 19th century. A post-Columbian epoch of closed space, of occupied and claimed territories, had arrived. World powers were now in a new struggle, a struggle over the relative efficiency of their use of the earthly spaces they already controlled. Empires needed to modernize how they organized and exploited their territorial holdings. Mackinder is a helpful figure in thinking about geopolitics. Sometimes described as the father of geopolitics, he was an aspirational organic intellectual of empire at the outset of the 20th century, an educator and writer who described the geographical foundations of world power and prescribed what the British Empire needed to do to strengthen its own foundations. Using Mackinder's work as a point of departure, this book develops a critical framework for the analysis of geopolitics as a set of competitive territorial practices by world powers. Here, I consider three distinct practices. 1. The pursuit of territorial security and control by competing world powers. 2. The competing missionary claims by world powers to organize global space. And 3. The drive to harness geospatial technologies to enhance the military power of states across the horizontal and vertical territories of the Earth. All of these practices are embedded in broader structures of modernity and global capitalism, so they operate alongside economic forms of occupying and organizing the Earth. Territory is a key term in this book. Drawing inspiration from contemporary geographical scholarship, I do not restrict it to a purely statist understanding, namely, as the legal property of the state. Rather, we live within multiple territorial regimes, from the geoecological to the geoeconomic and geopolitical. All these are entwined, though the geoecological and geoeconomic are often obscured and hidden in daily life. Also, I do not confine it to terra, to fixed dry land. To fully earth geopolitics requires recognition of the many territories beyond Terra: mountains, rivers, marshes, coastlines, deserts, lakes, ice sheets, glaciers, deltas, air spaces, sea floors, underground and underwater spaces, whose interactions are crucial to sustaining the world we find familiar. The structured way of seeing the planet, enabled by geopolitics, casts the world as a chessboard of rival great powers competing over hydrocarbon energy, strategic minerals, trade, finance, and people. This obscures the long-standing and now dangerously accumulating environmental costs of modernity. There is a disjuncture between the geopolitical world people live in and the actual material realities of geo-ecological processes. Many, if not most people, do not see themselves living within a fragile and precarious biosphere on a dynamic planet, even though they are, but in a world of geopolitical drama. The terms of this drama dominate the everyday life of states and arrange world powers against each other in struggles over economic resources, strategic states, civilizational values, world order, and ways of life. This is geopolitics world, compelling and absorbing, but also obscuring the Earth as an ecosphere. Geopolitics locks global politics into antagonistic territorial practices, justifying unsustainable exploitation of the planet's resources in the name of security, sovereignty, and freedom. In doing so, it accelerates the climate emergency while preventing collective action to address it. It deserves our full attention. Book outline. This book is called Oceans Rise, Empires Fall, because this felicitous phrase, which derives from the chorus of a song from the musical Hamilton, summarizes the clash that defines the present. This is the clash between Earth system dynamics and the world power structures that humans have built into and upon the planet, changing it in the process. It is a clash between the materiality of the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.